Good morning and welcome to Bridgepoint Church Online. I'm Joe Rohde, the high school pastor, and I'll be your host today. Before we get started, I want to draw your attention to some links in the description below. There you'll find our sermon notes, a connection card, or the link to our online community, Bridgepoint Home. We've got a great service in store for you today, so let's get started.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you.
inside, I doubt that you could love me. But in your eyes, there's only grace now. We believe. You clean my clothes. You ride my wrongs. You break my chains.
Good morning and welcome to Bridgepoint Church Online. My name's Adam. I'm the associate pastor here, and I get to be your guide through week two of our series, Undefeated. Last week, we kicked it off by talking about some foundational truths that we all had to be on the same page with in order to take in the entire series. And so let me give you a quick reminder. We started off by talking about the fact that there are two timelines, a physical timeline and a spiritual timeline, that really play out even though we don't actually see both of them. We're very aware of the physical timeline. That's where we live and breathe. It's what we study in school. This is what we call history in a lot of senses. But the spiritual timeline is one that is more difficult to get our head around. We talked about the fact that the spiritual timeline doesn't have a beginning or an end because it's tied to a pre-existent, all-existent being God that Christians follow and serve. And what we talked about was that on the spiritual timeline, things happen there that bubble up and show up in tangible ways on the physical timeline. In one instance, has huge importance, and it's what we spent a lot of our time on last week. We said that before our beginning, before we, however you think the world began, before our beginning, something happened on the spiritual timeline. A conflict began where an angel named Lucifer was caught up in his own pride. He led a coup against God, and God could not tolerate that, as no leader should. He put all of that down, and he sent Lucifer to this brand new place that had been created called Earth. And while he was there, he began trying to do the same things that he did in heaven on Earth. And he became not just Lucifer the angel, he became Satan, which is a title that means adversary. He became the adversary of God. Now, you probably work in a place that has some type of core values for your company. You may even have a purpose statement that's on the wall or something that HR has to talk to you about, you know, once a year to get everyone on the same page with. And this is very, very common. Most of the time they're kind of pithy or creative. Well, Satan has a very compact statement that he and all of his people, the other fallen angels that he rolls with, lives by. It's their purpose statement. And it basically goes something like this. At Satan Co., I don't know, maybe it's an LLC. I'm not sure, you know, how he is branded for tax purposes. But at Satan Co., we exist to steal, kill, and destroy the work of God. And we find this out, this is unveiled to us in John 10:10, where Jesus basically says, well, you know what Satan's trying to do. He's trying to steal, kill, and destroy. Here's where this gets really complicated and a little bit terrifying. We are the ones he is trying to steal, kill, and destroy, because we are the work of God. The Bible says that we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, that we are the ones that he's targeting. Not only that, we're made in the image of God that puts a special target upon us. We get the affection of God greater than any other created being. God has a special connection with humanity. And so Satan is trying to live this out in real time, right now before our eyes. And we don't always see it. It doesn't always show up how we might expect it, but it is always there on that spiritual timeline, working in the background, sometimes showing up in tangible, dramatic, terrifying ways on our physical timeline. And so what I want to do today is I want to give you a brief, undefeated history of the world. A brief undefeated perspective about how Satan has tried and tried and tried to live this purpose statement out, but failed and failed and failed over and over again. So we're going to start in Revelation chapter 12. Now, here's what you should know about Revelation. It's a book that is really a vision that was given to a disciple named John. John was at the end of his life. He had been exiled because of his faith and stand for Christ to an island that was a mining island called Patmos. While he was there, God gives him this dramatic vision. And the previous 11 chapters talk about these, you know, seven different churches that are throughout the area and give this great prophecy for them and point some things out. We get these dramatic pictures of the throne room of God. We see some judgments that God is going to roll down. We meet a couple characters. We meet the Antichrist, who is trying to stop the work of God. He'll be used by Satan to do that. And then when we get to chapter 12, we get this perspective. We get this figurative example of what has happened, and it really helps us understand how Satan works and what he's trying to do. Now, what's really cool about this is that we know the Bible was written to real people at a real time so they could really understand it. And although this figurative language that's given doesn't quite hit home with us as much, the original audience would have had so many jumping off points. For the Jewish people, the unbelieving Jewish people who would have been reading this or hearing people talk about this, this is a great picture that leans back to the garden in Genesis. It's like the fulfillment of that, because there's going to be a serpent, there's going to be a woman, there's going to be a child. It's a great illustration to that. But for the Greeks who were there, and really the Roman culture is basically a new version of the Greek culture in a lot of ways, they would have immediately, as they started to think about these characters, thought about the myth of the birth of Apollo. Because Apollo was born, and it is said in the mythology of all of this, that there was a snake, a python, waiting to try and kill this child. And later on, Apollo would grow up and he would actually kill the snake himself. Sound familiar? It should if you were listening with us last week. So let's actually meet these people for ourselves. It starts off, we're introduced to a woman. It says, now a great sign appeared in heaven. When you see this in the Bible, a great sign appeared in heaven, it helps us understand that this might be a figurative thing that we're supposed to read into a little bit. It says, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on the head a garland of 12 stars. So this is actually giving us the identity of this woman. Remember, this isn't written for an American audience, it's written for a Jewish audience. When the Jewish audience would have seen garland of 12 stars, they would have been like, oh, I know what he's talking about. That's talking about the dream that Joseph had back in Genesis when he's talking about his family and how they would become a significant family, that they would become, you know, the 12 tribes of Israel, basically. That's what he's talking about. So we understand from that that this woman is the nation of Israel. It's going to tell us her state now. Watch this. It says, then, beginning with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. Now, anytime in a figurative language setting, we see, a child or labor or pain to give birth, it's talking about the persecution or the trials or the turbulence or friction that comes before a purpose is ultimately fulfilled. It's talking about this process that of suffering that you have to go to be able to get to something really significant. And it's telling us that this woman who is Israel is being persecuted. She's being targeted because she's about to give birth. And there must be something incredibly significant about that child and the birth that they're going to have. Now, there's another side to this, though. We meet another character, and it is the dragon. It says, and another sign appeared in heaven, telling us we can take this figuratively. Behold, a great and fiery red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 diadems on its head. Again, we read this and think like, that's impossible. I don't know how anything could look like that. But the original audience for the Jewish people, when they read this, they'd be like, oh, you know what he's talking about? He's talking about Daniel chapter 7, that prophet that we all follow. And in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel has a vision of 4 of these beasts, almost this dream about these 4 different beasts. And each one of those beasts represents a world empire. And the Roman Empire is described as having this exact description. And so what this tells us is we can understand that the dragon is Satan or Lucifer, but it tells us that Satan is going to have access to empires and emperors. He's going to be able to wield nations to try and persecute and stop the work of God, to fulfill his purpose statement, that it isn't just going to be him out on his own. He's going to be able to harness mankind and government to bring that to bear against God's plans. Here it kind of gives us a little bit of a history lesson. His tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. Well, stars are often described, that's a description that's given to angels. And so it's giving us this perspective about what happened before our beginning and how Satan was cast to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child. And so this is such an incredible picture, because if you remember last week in Genesis 3:15, as God is doling out, you know, curses because people had fallen away from God, and he's angry and distraught and frustrated with mankind and Satan at this point, he looks at the serpent and says, I'm going to give you a twofold curse. One, the form that you are taken is going to be cursed. You're going to slither on your belly. But then he goes on to say, Satan, you got to know that there's going to come a day where a woman is going to bear a child, and that child is going to be a threat to you. You're going to attack him, and you're going to bruise his heel, but he will also be crushing your head. Satan, ever since that moment, has been waiting and watching and trying to wield the power of empires to devour and destroy that child before that child can destroy him. It's a little bit of like a Voldemort and Harry Potter thing going on. I mean, it is dramatic. And when we look at this, this could go a lot of different directions. But Satan begins to try and exercise this power that he has and accomplish this mission that he has throughout history. And we see this show up in very tangible ways. And I'm going to give you several stops along the way. So if you can't keep up when you're in your own Bible, just know you'll be able to see some of the references on here. So one of the first things that he does as he tries to, you know, devour this child, to stop his undoing before it starts, is that Satan tries to pollute the human race. So after the fall of man, this is before the great flood that we read about, you know, Noah's Ark, and, you know, 2 by 2, the animals go in, all of those kinds of things. Satan tries to intervene, and he thinks, well, maybe if I poison this race, then perhaps this person is never going to be able to come to end my purposes and end the reign that I'm trying to have. Look at Genesis 6, it spells this out. Then the people began to multiply on the earth, and the daughters were born to them. And the sons of God, this is also a reference to angels, but we're talking about fallen angels here, saw the beautiful women and took any they wanted as their wives. And if you were to keep reading this, you would discover that there was almost these demigod people. And this is like a time where if I had a time machine, I would have to go back and see this with my own eyes because it almost seems stranger than fiction. But then I think to myself, almost every single culture has stories about these half-god, half-people creatures, this different race of people. And could it be that it all stems from this moment and that this may have actually taken place? We just can't fathom it because we don't have a parallel for where we live and how we live now. And so this is what ends up happening. They take them as their wives. They have these children that are these half-breeds of people. And God says, I can't live and abide by this. The people become incredibly evil, and God has to completely start over. He has to wipe out this race of people. He preserves one group of people that has not been polluted, and they become the seeds of a brand new population after the flood. But Satan continues to try to destroy the work of God. Watch this. He also tries to eliminate the Jews through Pharaoh. So fast forward several hundred years now, we have seen Abraham come on the scene. God creates this special bond with Abraham, tells him he's going to form a great nation out of him. We see Joseph, who is able to help preserve this family through drought and famine, and they all come under the wing and protection of Egypt because Joseph is running Egypt, essentially. He's number two in charge. And then Satan sees this grand opportunity while he has this unprecedented access to Jewish people and sees the writing on the wall. He moves in the heart of Pharaoh to eliminate this group of people. He tells Pharaoh, they're threatening you. You've got to do something about this, Pharaoh. He's whispering behind the scenes, pulling strings behind the scenes. And Pharaoh succumbs to this plan. He's led into this deception. And listen to what Pharaoh does as he's threatened by the Jewish people. It says, the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, gave his order to the Hebrew midwives, Shiphrah and Puah. When you help the Hebrew women as they give birth, watch as they deliver. If it's a baby boy, kill him. If it's a girl, let her live. And so Satan's still trying to eliminate this race of people, that there can't be any pure blood people that would come from here, because he's obviously come to the conclusion that this group of people is the group of people that will be the ancestry home of the person who will destroy his head, that will crush his head. And so he's terrified. Well, God preserves. Once again, he brings a deliverer. Moses delivers the Jewish people from captivity, and now they're forming a nation, partly because of the pressure that Satan tried to impose on the Jewish people. He pushes one direction, God takes it a mile the other direction. It isn't just there though. Watch, several hundred years later, Satan tries to eliminate the people, the Jews, while they're in captivity again. So the Jewish people has forsaken God a couple hundred years before this, and God says, I've told you over and over and over again how to follow me and how you're supposed to have a relationship with me. You're not listening. And so I'm going to let you kind of take a field trip for a while. And the Babylonian people take them into captivity, and then the Persians conquer them. And now Satan has gotten into the ear of a man who works in the Persian court of Xerxes named Haman. And he uses the pride of Haman, who is slighted by a Jewish man named Mordecai, to ignite the fuse of genocide. He's trying to convince Haman to work within the government to eliminate the Jewish race completely as it sits in captivity there. Watch what Haman says to King Xerxes. He says, then Haman approached King Xerxes and said, there is a certain race of people. Now, this is never identified as the Jewish people, but we know this from the context of the rest of Scripture. Scattered through all of the provinces of your empire, who keep themselves separate from everyone else. Their laws are different from those of any other people, and they refuse to obey the laws of the king. So it is not in the king's interest to let them live. And what he goes on to do is he literally bribes the king and convinces the king to let him sign this law into order that would give Persian people the opportunity to kill any Jewish people, any Jewish person that they wanted without any recourse at all. The Jewish people literally can't defend themselves. It's terrible and just awful. I can't believe this actually happened. But once again, God had already elevated a young Jewish girl named Esther, who became just the treasure of King Xerxes, who had married her. And she's in this incredible place to be able to stop the work of Haman. And the story ends with Haman actually losing his life because of his deception and his intent to destroy the Jewish people. And Esther comes out as a hero. In fact, it's where we get the Jewish people get the Feast of Purim. It's an incredible turn of events, and God frustrates the plans of Satan once again. It doesn't stop there, though. The Jewish people are allowed to go back into their homeland. They rebuild the temple. They're able to rebuild the walls. They establish worship and everything. But once again, they fall away from God. They're not honoring him the way that they're supposed to be. And so God shuts the whole thing down. He says, I'm not speaking to you through prophets anymore. The next time I show up, it's going to be, you know, much, much different. And during that time, we don't actually have a narrative in scripture, but we can tell through history that Satan continues to try and stop the work of God and hurt the people of God. Satan tries to destroy the Jewish culture, religion, and people through a leader called Antiochus. Now, Antiochus was bent on spreading the Greek culture to everyone. It was called the Hellenization of the world. And so this was part of his plan. He had gotten this from Alexander the Great, who also had very similar plans. And he was so angry with the Jews in Jerusalem who wouldn't cooperate the way he wanted to cooperate, that this is how one historian recounts what happened. It says, so angry was Antiochus that in 168 BC, he set about to destroy every distinctive characteristic of the Jewish faith, wipe away their entire culture. He forbade all sacrifices, outlawed the rite of circumcision, canceled the observance of the Sabbath and the offering of sacrifices, and disallowed the celebration of feast days. Additionally, he mutilated and destroyed nearly every copy of the Hebrew Bible, trying to wipe their beliefs off the face of the earth. The Jews were forced to eat pork and make sacrifice to idols. His final act of sacrilege, and the one that spelled his ultimate ruin, was the desecration of the most holy place by building an altar and offering a sacrifice to the god Zeus. Many Jews died in the ensuing persecutions. So God is watching all of this happen, and he swoops in and he actually brings another empire, the Roman Empire, to take over this place. And suddenly, someone who wasn't necessarily a Roman, Herod, rises to power. And he becomes this great person overseeing Jerusalem and a few other areas. And he becomes almost a friend to the Jews initially. He rebuilds the temple, and it's a beautiful rendition of the temple. He has this incredible, prolific building program where he establishes entire cities that would be ports dedicated to, you know, the Caesar. And he builds this great relationship with the Roman leadership. And all seems like it's going to be okay. Like, he's not a great guy, but he's also not like crazy, terrible guy at this point. But he begins to go nuts at the end of his life. He begins to become very suspicious of every single person. And Satan then tries to destroy the Jewish generation through Herod the Great. Satan knows the clock's ticking. And all of a sudden, these scholars, these wise men who were from a different country, show up, who had been studying the stars, and they say, hey, there's something we've never seen before, and there's this king being born in Bethlehem. And so he begins to freak out. Herod decides, I have got to do something to shut all of this down and stop this, because I'm the king, and I'm not giving this up. I'm going to pass this along to my kids. No one is taking this from me. I've worked too hard for all of this. Well, we kind of know the Christmas story, right? The wise men show up. They're told by an angel that, you know, Herod is literally trying to kill this child. And so they take off. And this is what it says in Matthew 2:16. It says, Herod was furious. He was incensed when he realized that the wise men had outwitted him. He sent soldiers to kill all the boys in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under. He wants to wipe out an entire group of people. Can't you see Satan behind the scenes saying, like, we got to stop this now? Appealing to the pride of Herod, just like he appealed to the pride of Haman and the pride of the Egyptian Pharaoh, to try and end this so that this child couldn't be born that would spell his doom. And it says, it goes on to say that the people, that Jesus's family escapes to Egypt. And they show back up after Herod dies, that God intervenes once again. And it's tragic, the number of people that Satan kills in the wake of all of this as he tries to stop the work of God. But the greatest work is still alive and still viable as the baby Jesus begins to grow up and take his place in destiny. Now, the outcome is actually spelled out back in Revelation 12:5. This is what this child is born to do. And I think you know it, but this is what we see. It said, she bore a male child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. That rod of iron isn't this picture of oppression. It's a picture of justice. It's saying everyone will be treated uniquely and fairly in when all of this kingdom comes to bear. And her child was caught up to God. You know what caught up means? It's a picture of the resurrection. It's when Jesus died on the cross, and then 3 days later, he rises again and goes to be with his Father in heaven until he will come back to earth at the right time to set up and rule the nations with a rod of iron, a fair, equitable place where everyone is treated the way that they should be treated. That's the picture. And here's the point. At every stage, in other stages that I didn't even mention, God frustrates the plans of Satan. He denies the progress that Satan tries to make and ultimately thwarts the purpose that Satan has. Now, when I think of all of this and what it actually means for you and I actually go back to the playground in fourth grade. When I was a kid, and everyone has this kid at recess, there was a kid named Ardale Daniels. And Ardale Daniels was like the stud of elementary school. I mean, he could do no wrong. It was incredible. What you knew is that if Ardale picked you to be on his team, you know, because he was always the captain, you were going to win the game. I mean, no stopping it. Maybe some of you were that kid. I was never that kid. Well, here's the side of it. I would sit there and wait. You know, you're kind of in your group and you're kind of like, Ardale, over here. I'll give you my sandwich at lunch. You want my chocolate milk? I mean, you would do whatever you could to be on Ardale's team because you would win and it's fun to win. Ardale hardly ever picked me because he didn't want to drag my dead weight around the soccer field, the basketball court, or whatever we were playing at that time. And I would always leave feeling like, oh, I wish I could be on Ardale's team. Because it's the winning team. And here's what we learn about Jesus. We don't have to wait around and hope that he invites us to be a part of his team. The Bible says in John 12:32, it's Jesus saying, he says, and when I'm lifted up from the earth, that's a reference to the cross. When they would nail him on the ground and they had to erect the cross up and make it stand in front of everyone. When I'm lifted up, it's like an antenna that's sending a signal that says, I will draw everyone to myself. That as Jesus dies on the cross, it's like an invitation has been sent for every single person who will ever breathe, that everyone has an opportunity to choose to be on God's team. You don't have to wait for God to choose you and hope that you're good enough for God to choose you and let you in and let you be a part of what he's doing to be on the winning team. Everyone has the opportunity to be drawn to myself or to himself or to Jesus Christ, the ultimate victor, the ruler of the world. And when we do that, the message that's being sent, the truth that we get to live out is this, that Christ's victory becomes our victory. The reason that everyone wanted to be on Ardale's team was because we were going to win the game. But none of us were stupid enough to think that we won because of us. Like, it was Ardale's victory. We just got to be on the team when it happened. Christ's victory is our victory in that exact same way. Look at how 1 Peter 3-4 puts this. It says, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by His great mercy that we have been born again, that we've gotten a fresh start, a new opportunity, because God raised Jesus from the dead, the resurrection power that defeats death, the only thing that mankind can't escape. Now we live with great expectation. What's the expectation? The expectation is the end of the game when we are standing victorious. In the third quarter of a basketball game, when you're up by 50, what you are excited about is the trophy ceremony. That's the great expectation we have. And we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change or decay. That when we align ourselves with Jesus Christ and become part of His undefeated team, we have access to a ceremony, a place, a hall of fame, if you want to think about it that way, where nothing can ever be touched or tarnished or taken away from us in that respect. And not only do we get to experience Christ's victory, but Christ's power becomes our power. This is where my example about Ardale falls short, because Ardale could never pour his savvy and his athleticism and his, you know, intelligence about how to get where the ball is going to be and his tactical skill and all of that. He could never translate that to me. I mean, he ended up going to West Point and, you know, being running back for Army. I was never going to do that. But what we have in Jesus is someone who gives us his power, who literally saves us. And as we join his team, we don't just get a jersey. He pours himself into us and gives us his Holy Spirit and empowers us to be a part of this conflict. He empowers us to inject ourselves to also frustrate the plans of Satan and join in a brand new purpose that God has ordained since the beginning of time. And this is the last idea. Christ's purpose. This is what the scripture says. It says, "You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." That's what we got in us. That's the power we have. That's the opportunity that we have. And it's all for a purpose. Because not only is Christ's victory our victory and his power our power, Christ's calling is our calling. Just like Satan has made it very clear what he's come to earth to do. He said, "I've come to steal, kill, and destroy the work of God." God has his own spin on all of that. He has told us in 1 John, in Luke 19:10, he says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who are lost." Those who are not playing for his team, he has come to invite them to be part of that. He has come to save them from the consequences and the vulnerability that they have because Satan is coming for them and wants to destroy them. That's what we have access to. And we're invited into that. God's power has prepared us to participate in that. And here's why this becomes incredibly important. There is so much in this world that we can do. And there's very kind and, you know, people who are well-meaning, who are participating and doing some great things in the world. We can, you know, feed children. We can, do what we can to raise awareness about injustice and things that are happening in the world. We can, you know, step in and be kind to other people, you know, through normal graces of every day. And we should do all of those things. But we have to realize, when we do those things, if we make that the main point of our life, we are actually only treating symptoms of a greater problem. Mankind's greatest problem follows us all the way from that garden in Eden, and it has never stopped. It is relentless. It is the sin nature that we have. The problem with mankind is that we can be held in bay by laws and this perception of who we want to be in front of other people. But when people aren't watching and the lights go off, and when we think we can get away with it, we will exploit other people. We will lie to get ahead. We will put ourselves before other people. We do this because it's in us, because sin is in us. And until we deal with the sin problem that we have, we're never going to be able to fully just break away from the hold that Satan and sin have on our life. And that's what Jesus has come to give us freedom from. That if we want a more just society, we need a more saved society. If we want a place where people put themselves second and try to look out for the benefits of others, that's what Jesus has been telling us to do. But we can't do it naturally. We need the power of God to do that in us. And when that happens, that changes the game. And so here's what this means practically for you and me. If you have never placed your faith in Jesus, if you've never joined his team, what are you waiting for? Jesus literally left heaven to come to earth, dropped into our timeline to be able to give you a bridge to get to the other side, to be able to give you a bridge, an opportunity to, of your own free will, join his team and be a part of destiny, of something new, of an undefeated team. Why would you try to do it any other way? And so what I would ask you, I know you're sitting staring at a screen at home or looking at a phone or something like that. What I'm going to ask you, would you consider joining the undefeated team of Jesus Christ? It's simple. So simple that it almost seems like it doesn't even work. But if you talk to the millions of people, the billions throughout time and history who have placed their faith in Jesus, we know it makes a difference. You say a simple prayer that says, God, I can't do it on my own. I need you to come into my life. I want to play for your team. Everything I'm doing is creating a defeat in my life. I know you died on the cross for me. Thank you so much for doing that. And you rose again, and that proves you're undefeated. I want on your team, God. If you say a simple prayer like that, you transfer teams, trade jerseys, and join the undefeated team that God has invited all of us to be a part of. Here's another group of people that's probably watching this. You might be watching at home right now, and you're very comfortable with everything we're talking about. You could have given this sermon, right? I mean, you may have even heard this sermon before. Here's what I would push you on a little bit. Are you involved in things that matter to God? Are you driven by things that matter to God? When's the last time that you've tried to help someone follow Jesus? Maybe it's as simple as inviting them to church. Maybe it's looking for ways to inject your faith into conversations. Maybe it's giving someone a Bible or some type of religious material that helps guide their way. Maybe it's inviting someone to a Bible study. Maybe it's literally telling someone the difference that Jesus has made in your life and asking and trying to help them find out how Jesus can make a difference in their life. If you aren't doing that, you're missing it. I mean, I got to tell you, you're missing it. Jesus is the only one who can take away the condemnation and sin and weight that we all feel. And this is the best thing that anyone can do for anyone, is to try and introduce them to Jesus. So is there a name? Is there a person? Is there someone who's on your heart, in your mind, and you're a little bit scared and you're a little bit worried and you don't know how to do it, but you just know, I got to bring this up. I got to do something. I've got to help this person follow Jesus. Pray for that person. You can start there. But bring it up. Go there. Make an invite. Do something. Because why would you sit on the bench when God has empowered you to be part of the game, that you and I are involved in this conflict in a positive way, and we get to pursue the purposes of God? And what do you got to lose? We both know that we're playing on an undefeated team, and that there is nothing that anyone can do to us that would steal the outcome from us. Let me pray for you. God, I want to thank you for your grace to us. Lord, I can't even put into words the amazing thought of how we are transferred from death to life, that we get to play on an undefeated team, that we get to be part of your family, God. It's just such a beautiful truth. But God, I realize that there are some people who have never had that. And so God, today, would you just haunt us with this reality? That there is a war going on, and we must choose a side, and we must participate in the battle, in the fight. God, we love you, and thank you for your grace to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Coming up in 2 weeks is Easter Sunday. We're going to have 3 in-person services at 9:30, 11, and 12:30. If you can't join us in person, join us online at 11 a.m. This announcement is for all the fellas. Coming up on April 10th at 9 a.m. is our men's recharge breakfast. So we know how much food to make. We need you to let us know how many people are coming. The best way for you to do that is jump on your Church Center app or go to bridgepointchurch.com/events. Thanks for doing that, and we'll see you there. Hey, it's been a great time here at Bridgepoint Church Online. I want to invite you back same time next Sunday as we continue our series Undefeated. Have a great week.